please. I hope you're having an awesome 2017 so far. Amazing. My 2017 almost started out bad. What is his name?
Excuse me. Good morning, everybody. If we can get everybody to come in from the back, that'd be totally awesome. And thank you. I know it's a holiday, and people are either not awake yet or still sleeping, like really not awake. Maybe here, but still not awake. Okay. Michael has so many important things to tell you that you really should listen to him. Good morning. I love you.
I'm not a mother. I can't do that. No, no, no. Quick story, though, to 2017. I get here to church this morning, and I'm trying to open the door, and it wouldn't open. It would not open. My key worked, and I turned it, and it would not open. And so I'm starting to freak out, like, oh, here comes the devil. The door won't open. And the keypad light is staring at me. And if you don't know about the keypad light, during daycare time, there's a keypad. And the door is unlocked, but if you don't have the number, you can't, like, get in. And so it's staring at me, but I'm like, no, it can't be the keypad lock because it's supposed to be off on the weekends. And so I'm like jerking the door violently. I was jerking violently, trying to get in. And the light is still staring at me. And I'm like, it can't be the light. It can't be that thing. And so finally I call Pastor Ricky, and his phone was turned off. Went straight to voicemail. Glad to know he's there for me. And then I call Pastor Annette, and she's like, hello. And proceed to tell her that I can't get in the church. And she's like, is the light on? I'm like, yeah, it's on. The light on the keypad is on. But the other portion is I don't know the code. So anyway, 2017 almost got me, but I beat it. So anyway, just a quick story for you. Anyway, how many of you got a bulletin? Good. Who did them? Amber Schaefer did our bulletins. Now, these are vital to not leave on the floor when service is over. Please use them. They have all kinds of information in them. They have service times. They have who our pastors are. Talk about prayer, worship, and most importantly, they have, what are these? Announcements, those things. They have those in there. And then on the back, notes space, because everyone should be taking notes, because even though we all try to be mentally sound, come on, let's be honest, about 5 minutes into the service we all about tune out. We'll just you know, it is what it is. Okay, whatever. Anyway, announcements. Today is Missions Sunday, so if you would like to give a special offering towards missions, you can write it on the envelope. You can do it on the app. You can do it online. We have a missions specified Sunday. Yeah, pledge if you adopted a kid from Sri Lanka. I got it. Yes! Finally got it. Usually it's Peru or some other Syria. I say something else. Sri Lanka. If you would like, do you still have kids available?
We have two new orphans that were now being taken care of by Shepherd's Heart, and they just got all of their information and picture in the mail. So I'm actually going to be putting up some information over here that will be constant of all the kids. And also, if you're giving to that, just you can put SHO for Shepherd's Heart Orphanage. And, of course, you can still give to the mission in Mexico. You can just say Mexico on there. Or you can also still give to the Quechua tribes in Peru. And matter of fact, Freddie, who's over ATEC, he has been concentrating, the Lord told him to concentrate on youth. So what's amazing is now they're having youth revivals in the mountains. You have to understand, when I say this, it's not like in Temple, and we call some people over from Belton and they come over. I mean, we're talking about miles and miles and miles in the Andes Mountains. And so for these kids to come together, it's a phenomenon. I mean, really. And they're having the smallest youth revival that they had was 200 youth. They're having upwards to 400 to 500 kids trekking through the mountain range to come be filled with the Holy Spirit. I mean, it's an amazing, I've seen the pictures and the videos, and it's absolutely just mind-boggling what God is doing. So we are really, I'll be going to some of the youth revivals probably in April. So I'm super excited about what God's doing with Freddie and ATEC. So I promised Freddie that he'd be getting monthly support from us as well. So if you want to give to Peru, if you're going to do your pledge to Shepherd's Heart, or if you want to give to Mexico Mission, just indicate on there which mission you want to go to, okay?
Amen. Did you get all that? Cool. And then also the first Sunday of every month, we will have a coffee and donut fellowship in the back. And you can, all the proceeds, if you donate towards that, will go to missions as well. But it's also a time for you just to be able to connect with one another over coffee and donuts, because there's nothing like a sugar high right before service. And then on the 8th, we have Baptism Sunday at the end of service. If you want to be baptized, if you want to be rebaptized, then see Pastor Nona, Pastor Rob, or any of the other pastors, and we will get you signed up for that. And then on the 15th, we have Intro to the Point immediately following service. It will not be at 5 p.m. It will be at the 5th Street Building. They will give you pizza if you go, so that's always a plus. If you don't know what Intro to the Point is, it's a time where you sit down with the pastors and they share the heart of the church, the vision, where the church came from, where it is now, and where God is taking us. And then singles group, how many people are single? Good, there's enough. He will be. Anyway, the singles group is having a lunch at Dynasty today, immediately following service. So if you're single and you want to go hang out with a bunch of other singles, then go. You should probably go because you're in trouble. And then on the 8th, next Sunday, there will be a teachers' meeting immediately following service. It will not be long. If you are involved in children's ministry, or you are even having an inclination that you want to be involved in children's ministry, it will probably be over there. Big room back here. If you don't know where the big room is, you need to go explore the church. It's back there. So please go. If you're not involved in a ministry and you want to get plugged into something, just check it out. You're not going to, like, sign your life away, and we're not going to, like, you know, put chains on you and force you to do it. Just go check it out and see what Holy Spirit tells you to, because you never know. And then on the 14th, we are having a picnic in the park. Is this for children only? I know it's everybody. If you have kids, if you don't have kids, you can probably still come out. We won't, like, ignore you or anything. They're going to have flag football for pretty much everybody, because they said, like, ages 6 to something, but we know all the old people that still think they're athletic are going to play anyway. So I'm not athletic at all. I will attest to that any day of the week. But anyway, it's a time for us just to fellowship, have a get-together, let the kids go off and be kids, and you can have sanity around other adults. That'll be at 11 a.m., obviously depending on weather, because Texas seems to be very bipolar right now. That's okay. And then small groups meet every third Saturday, so the next time small groups meet will be on the 21st. If you are a small group leader, would you raise your hand real quick? So if you are not a small group leader, look at the people who have their hands up, and these people, you will go to their homes, you will fellowship, play games, eat food, maybe look at the Bible, I don't know. But get hooked up with a group. Go spend time with people who are like-minded. Go be encouraged. Go be loved on. Go love on others. Small groups are vital. It's a chance to grow closer, more intimately in a non-church environment, and just hang out and have fun. And then we're also looking for volunteers. For the Helps Ministry, you can see Bill Mills. If you can help Children's Ministry, that will be in the Children's Meeting. Am I not supposed to do this? Okay, he's just got that look. Sorry, it's freaking me out. Anyway, I don't like the look. I'm just going to do like this. An assimilation team, we need greeters. stop laughing. If you have a friendly face or a friendly smile, or if you don't, that is a good place to learn how to get one. Yeah, you have to see my wife, and she'll help you learn how to smile. She did it for me. It's not forced, I swear. Anyway, all right, that's about it for announcements. That's about it for me for 2017. See you later, guys.
Nothing like starting a new year off a little discombobulated, right? So, look, there's some people that are out sick, people that are out on vacation, but we are here to have a wonderful time this morning. Amen? So next week, we'll get it all ironed out. We have a few wrinkles. It's no big deal, right? Amen. Praise God. Grace, grace to your mountain. Hallelujah. So you are the special few who get to hear what the Lord told me first thing this morning. I don't think anybody else is excited about that. God from heaven actually spoke this morning, like literally spoke, and we're like, yeah, whatever. He said it again. Okay, no. Okay, well, because I do, this is definitely, I haven't ironed this all out either, so, sorry, I'm having a hard time bending. Thank you. Wood chip, where'd that come from? I had a dream, and I won't tell you the whole thing, but in my dream, my daughter and I were driving down the road, and I knew, I was on a farm-to-market road, and I knew that there was a lot of construction around this road, but not on the road. And it brings back a time in the beginning of 2016 when, do you remember like when every time you'd go somewhere and anywhere in Temple and Belton, every road was under construction? Do you remember that? It still pretty much is, but remember when it first started? I mean, even the routes that you used to take to get away from all the construction started having construction done on them, and God was like, hello, I am rearranging your entire life. Hello, everything is under construction. That was a prophetic word then. So, and that was not, I was not happy about that. So anyway, so in this one, I'm driving down a road that had no construction. I'm totally happy. It was sunny outside. It was a beautiful day. Everything was very, very, very green, which is very important. And I said, Ashlyn, did you see that? And she said, see what? And I'm like, oh God. And what I saw, there's a lot more to it, but what I saw was when I looked over to my left, which we, if you think about spiritual interpretation, the things that are to our left, they begin with the hidden things, the things that we don't see right away. So why she didn't see it, but I did, okay? And this is, so what I'm about to tell you are things that are going to be happening in our lives that are not going to be necessarily churchy things or things within our heart that God is doing, okay? And what I noticed was a huge blade that was coming up out of the ground, and it was cutting a huge, it was like a almost like I would say a rut, but it wasn't a rut. It was, this blade was moving very quickly through the ground, and I knew that it was cutting a brand new road that had never been there before. And I watched the blade spinning very quickly, and I could tell where the road was going to be, and I could also see how deep they were going to have to cut this plat of land out in order to put the road there. But all I saw was the blade. I saw no people, nothing. And as I sat there, I thought to myself, oh my gosh, I wonder if that blade is something that's an automatic thing, or is somebody having to be at the bottom of that trench and moving that blade along? I know that sounds like a crazy thing, but you have to, your dreams don't make sense, right? And so I explained to Ashlyn how I'd seen this blade, and I knew that there was a new road coming onto this very nice road that had not been touched in a while. And it was very green. I knew new things were happening, but I knew that God was putting a new road in for us. As I got to be by myself in the dream, I asked the Lord, I said, okay, so is that blade being driven by an automatic, like a conveyor thing that they set up underground and then they let the blade come in? I mean, it makes no sense. I know it sounds kind of crazy, but, or was somebody actually moving the blade along? And the Lord said to me that here's the thing. He said, what would be easier? I said, well, it would be easier if it just was something that was set up and the blade, you just hit start and the blade just went on there and did everything that it had to do. Because if I was a person having to move a blade along this trench, I would have to deal with darkness and wetness and dampness and bugs. Ooh, I don't like bugs and all those kind of things, right? And the Lord said, well, that's the opportunity that you have in front of you. And here's the thing. We can either go on this new road the way that God has said and already established very easily. He's already set up a system that puts us into the new thing, the thing that cuts through everything, and that's the Word of God, and that's Jesus Christ. You don't have to deal with darkness. You don't have to deal with bugs. You don't have to deal with all the inconveniences of going through whatever the new thing God wants you to do. If you'll put yourself onto the thing that he has already established that cuts through. Or you can say, you know what? I think I want to do this my way. And you can go and you can actually do it by yourself. You can actually get into this rut and you can be the one that's moving the blade and doing the things in front of you, but you have to deal with all of the other crap. But why do that when something has already been established that's so easy for us to go in and deal with it? And I really believe, as I woke up, I was writing it down and I was just sitting there meditating. And there's a lot more to it, some other things that happened that are not, I don't want to reveal right now, but the main thing is this, that God is telling us that he is cutting out a new road for us. There is something very new that's coming. We know there's been construction. God's already been dealing with so many things that are on our hearts individually, and he's been dealing with things corporately. But it was only setting us up, really, to get us acclimated to having to deal with construction and hardships and those kind of things and getting us ready for the thing that he's actually cutting out for us. This is for us. There was nobody else on the road but us. And there were other people in the church that ended up being involved with this. But it was just, I'm talking about something that's just for this church. I'm not talking about a corporate word for the church worldwide. I'm talking about just for the point that there's something very specific that he is cutting out for us. And if we will rest in doing it his way, it's going to be very, very, very easy. But if we start to do things our way, we will still get to the road, but it will be hard. And we will deal with some circumstances that we don't like to deal with. So what's the hidden things that God wants to deal with us in? Remember, the left side are things that are not public. So he's talking about private time, the sword of the Spirit, the blade of God going through our own hearts and spending that time in devotion with him and doing the things in the secret place that we're required to do because we love him. That devotional time, that makes all the other things very easy. Amen. I don't know what this new thing looks like. I don't have a clue. But I do know that it's cleansing. I do know that it's very prosperous. And I do know that it has a lot of people that end up going on the road that we've never seen before. Amen. I'm excited for what God wants to do. Are you? So let's start it out right. You know what I mean? Let's take a step today in worship and in praise and in adoration and saying, you know what, God, we want whatever it is you want for us. And let's not make it hard. Boy, we are so good at making things hard, aren't we? Oh. We stand to our feet. Thank you, Lord. Father, we just want to thank you and give you honor and glory and praise. There were so many wonderful and beautiful things that were accomplished in our lives in the last 12 months. And we know that we're not on the calendar of this world. We're on your holy calendar. But even today, Lord, as we just join ourselves in faith to take a step into something very new for us as a body and as individuals, we just lay hold of your word by faith, and we want you to do whatever it is that you want to do within us. We know that there is a wonderful blessing and wonderful breakthrough that you have for your bride in the 12 months that are to come. So, Father, we just say yes today with new conviction, with new faith, with new joy. We say, have your way. Do whatever it is that you want to do. We speak grace right now to every mountain that would loom itself up over us. that would try to hinder us. We say breakthrough is here. We say the season of having our minds made up to run after you is here. That we will not be wavering to and fro, but we have set our faces like flint, and we will run after you to the high place to bring forth the new road that many will come on. We thank you for a great harvest this year, Jesus. Put your sickle in and have your way. We worship you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. If you want to plant a seed this morning into it by faith, I don't normally do stuff like this, but I really do believe this. If you want to just plant a seed of faith to say, Lord, I just believe what you said you were going to do, you're going to do. And if you just want to plant a seed into it by faith and just believe God for a harvest, then do so today and write on there for the new thing, whatever it is you want that is. And plant it in faith this morning as you worship. If not, don't. Bring your tithes and offerings. Are we doing it to the front? Are we gathering? Are we doing it? We'll do it after praise and worship? Okay. So hold your offering unless you want to bring it. Y'all ready to worship Jesus? Come up to the front.
praise will ever be on my lips. Ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips.
We declare ever your praise on my lips.
Your praise will ever be on my lips. Ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips.
We declare
ever
your praise on my lips.
Your praise will ever be on my lips. Ever be on my lips.
Your praise
will ever be on my lips. Ever be on my lips.
Have you got pain? He's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you've got chains, he's a chain break. Come on. Every time we have a great practice in the morning, the enemy always comes to steal the joy out of service in the beginning. Can we break that right now? I knew it. Come on. Yes. We choose him above all else this morning. We choose him every second of the day because he is faithful, he is good, and he is coming again. Yes. We give you our yes. We give you our yes.
If you've got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker.
If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior.
If you've got chains, he's a chain breaker.
Come on, sing it again.
If you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker.
If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior.
You got chains, he's a chain breaker.
Come on, tell him your praise, 'cause your praise will
ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips.
We declare ever your be praise on my lips.
Your praise will ever be on my lips.
Oh, yes.
Ever be on
we
my lips.
Your praise will
ever be on my
yes.
lips.
Come on, your ever praise, tell him again.
Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips.
With our heavens, we will sing, sing, sing. Grateful that you hear us when we shout your praise. Lift high the name of Jesus.
Come on. We came to give him a new praise this morning. Tell him we can sing.
So sing, sing, sing.
Come on.
And make music
yes,
with the
make
heavens.
Music this
we
morning.
Will sing, sing,
oh, yes.
sing. Grateful that you hear us when we shout your praise. Lift high the name of Jesus.
Come on, tell them again, we say.
So sing, sing, sing. And make music with the heavens, we will sing, sing, sing. Grateful that you hear us when we shout your praise. Lift high
on,
the
yes.
name of
Come
Jesus.
On. Do it one more time. Say, sing to the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords.
and make music. Come on. With the heavens we will sing, sing, sing. Grateful that you hear us when we shout your praise. Lift high the name of Jesus.
Come on now, I want you to tell him your praise this morning. Just sing it out. Your praise will ever be on my lips. Ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips. Ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips. Ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips. Ever be on my lips. I want to hear the power of your word. I want to feel the weight of glory fall. I want to know the one who overcomes. I want to see, I want to be undone. Come on, sing it again. I want to hear. I want to hear the power of your word. Come on, declare it out.
I want to feel the weight of glory fall.
I want to know
the one who overcomes.
I want to see, I want to be undone. So come. Spirit, come
rushing like a flood. Heaven opened up.
Come on, sing it out this morning.
So come, never-ending waves. I am swept away. Holy Spirit, come.
I want to hear the voice that storm obeys. I want to feel your presence in this place. I want to know a pure and righteous love. I want to see, I want to be undone.
So come, Holy Spirit,
come.
Rushing like a flood. Heaven open up.
Come on, just reach out.
Come, never ending waves. I am swept away. Holy Spirit, come.
Come on, do it again. Say, come.
So come, Holy Spirit, come. Rushing like a flood. Heaven open up. Come, never ending ways. I am swept away. Holy Spirit, come.
Come,
fall afresh on me. Fall afresh on me. Come, come. Fall afresh on me. Fall afresh on me.
Come on, do it again.
Come, come. Fall afresh on me. Fall afresh on me.
Come on, do it again.
Come.
this morning.
Me. Say it again.
Nothing else I know. Nothing else, nothing else comes close.
Yes.
Nothing else, nothing else I know. Nothing else, nothing else comes close.
Come on, invite him again. Say, come.
So come. On me, fall afresh on me.
Come on, ask him to come.
Come, come, fall afresh on me. Fall afresh on me.
Come on, fall afresh, yes.
Come, come, fall afresh on me. Fall afresh on me.
Come on.
So come, come.
Come on, ask.
Fall afresh
on,
on,
yes.
Me. Fall afresh on
come.
Me.
Yes.
Come, come. Fall afresh on me. Fall afresh on me.
And I just want you to close your eyes. And I want you to just commit right now that anything that was done in 2016, those moments are over. The new is here, and you're stepping in greater measure. Your yes is not the yes it was last year. It's a new yes. It's a committed yes. It's a more sacrificial yes unto the King. Come on. Come on. He's a good God. When you come back before him, he just wipes it clean. Oh, come on. There's no other God that does that. There's no other God that can do that. He is the only one. Come on, yes. So I want you to ask him again. Say, come and fall afresh on me. Come on. Yes. Yes.
On me,
fresh on me. Fresh on me.
Come on, say come.
Come, come. Fall afresh on me. Fall afresh on me. Come, come. Fall afresh on me.
Come on, lift your voice.
Fall afresh on me.
Come on.
Me.
Reach out. Come on, yes.
Come, come. Fall afresh on me.
Just close your eyes.
Fall
afresh. Sing it out to him.
Me.
Ask him again. Say, come.
Come, come. Fall afresh on me. Fall afresh on me.
Come on, keep singing it.
Come, come, fall afresh on me.
Come on.
Fall afresh on me.
Come on, you don't receive because you don't ask. Do it again.
Come, come.
Come on, ask. Yes.
Fall afresh on me.
Come on, ask.
Fall afresh on me.
Come on, ask.
Come. Fall afresh on me.
Come on.
Fall afresh on me.
Come on, bride, ask your groom.
Come, come. Fall afresh on me.
Come on, keep asking.
Fall afresh on me.
Yes, come.
Come, come. Fall afresh on me. Fall afresh on me. Come, come. Fall afresh on me.
Come on.
Fall
one
afresh
more time,
on me.
All you've got. Say come.
Come, come. Fall afresh on me. Fall afresh on me. Come,
Holy Spirit, come.
nothing else I know. Nothing else comes close. Nothing else I know. Nothing else comes close.
Come on, tell him nothing.
Nothing else I know. Barren plain, so my heart had turned conflict.
shaken. Oh, my hope is in you.
Come on, tell him again. My hope is in you.
My hope is in you, God. I am steadfast. I will not be moved. I'm anchored, never shaken. All my hope is in you.
Come on, he brings hope. He's bringing hope to the hopeless and giving his heart to the broken and sharing his home with the orphan. He is the joy, he is my joy, he is the hope of the nations. The Father's heart we're embracing, he is the song we're declaring. He is the joy, he is my joy,
he's bringing hope to the hopeless. To the broken and sharing his home with the orphan. He is my joy,
yes.
He is my joy. He is the hope of the nations. The Father's heart we're embracing. He is the song we're bearing. He is the joy.
He's bringing
he joy. He's bringing hope to the hopeless and giving his heart to the broken. Sharing his home with the orphan. He is the joy, he is my joy. He is the hope of the nations. The Father's heart we're embracing. He is the song we're declaring. He is the joy, he is my joy.
all praise and honor and glory. Do number five. I don't want to preach yet. And I don't think it's just me. I think it's the Holy Ghost. I think there's some stuff we need to lay down. Can you got me a little hot? Let's hear your voice.
With all I have, no greater love than this, than to lay down my life. Cause I have found a love that is worthy of all I have. Given
come on, there we go.
For this
there we go. Richard, get me back up. There we go.
Lay it all down.
Lay it all down.
To the King of Kings, I lay it all down.
all down, lay it all down, lay it all down, lay it all down.
We want more of you. We
lay it all down, lay it all down, lay it all down, lay it all down.
So quickly, but as that was going, I heard, lay down that offense, lay down that entitlement, lay down that desire, lay down that sin, lay down, you know what it is. I think within this church, we've picked up so much. We've picked up so many offenses. We've picked up so many entitlements. I deserve to take a weekend off. I deserve to go do this. I deserve to do that. I deserve, I deserve, I deserve. And all of it is from being unfulfilled. And it didn't quite work out the way it was supposed to. It didn't turn out the way I planned. And there's... So I'll do it my way. And the Lord's saying, lay it down. Lay it down. I'm not beating you up. I'm the chiefest of sinners. That's not a you're bad and I'm good. That's a, we've picked up some things we need to put down. We've picked up some things that we are not ours. We've picked up some things that we shouldn't have picked up. But there's also some that those are the bad things. But then he said, we've picked up some cares and some burdens and some things that we're carrying that we don't need to carry, that they're his responsibility, that he has them under control. And it may be finances, and it may be a job, and it may be this, it may be that, but the Lord says, lay it down, I've got it. Lay it down, I've got it. Dear Heavenly Father, I lift up this congregation and I speak, I blow wind of life and I breathe the breath of life on them, Father God. And I just ask, Father God, for a refreshing, a new hope, a new desire, Father God, a new hunger. And that they would lay down all that they've picked up that's not theirs to carry. And they would pick up their cross and carry their cross only. Father, I love you and I praise you. And I thank you so much. Even for the tough times, even for the difficult times, even for the problems, and for even for being overcome and overwhelmed. It's just shown me who I am and what really I need, and that's you. So one last time as we run through Lay It All Down, I want you to think of what you've picked up and you need to lay down. And I hate resolutions because they all fade away in a week. But I want you to resolve in your heart to seek his face, to do whatever that is to lay down. If it's an offense, if it's an issue, whatever it is, whatever he brings to your heart, I want you to declare that this morning, to lay it down and let him have it.
Lay it all down.
grab someone's hand and squeeze it tight. Dear Heavenly Father, we say yes and amen this morning. We say, come, Lord Jesus, come. Fill us again with your presence. Fill us again with your joy and fill us again with your hope. Let us know that we have destiny. We're called forth and called to come out, to step forward. And all God's people said, amen and amen. You may be seated.
Did you get something? Did you get something? No, I was talking about something else. Ushers, if you would get to your spots, please. Today, Michael. Let's bow our heads and pray over this tithe and offering. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you tonight or today, and we just ask for your blessing upon this offering. We just ask, Father God, for you to cause us to multiply, Father. Thank you for giving us the ability to have incomes, to be fruitful. And Father God, we want to honor you with our first fruits and our tithe and our offering. And all God's people said, amen and amen. You can give online as well. Go ahead, guys, pass it around. Thank you, Jesus. Go with me, if you would, to Isaiah chapter 43. Where did I say go? I'm glad y'all are listening. Awesome. Amen. All right. First thing I want to do is who has faith? Who has faith they believe that, for healing? Okay, I want you to go lay hands on Nona. Whoever raised their hand. Y'all bring that tithe and offerings up here when you're finished. All right, be gentle with her. She's fragile. She's old. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you. And your word says, someone put some oil on her, that, Father, that if there's any sick among you, that anoint with oil, pray the prayer of faith, and they shall be made whole. Father, you said come before the elders and let the elders pray. So, Father, according to your word, you said that by his stripes we were healed. Father, me especially have allow too much of the enemy to take away our promises and our gifts. This year is different. Today we declare healing, not based on our power, not based on our will, not based on our need, but according to your word, according to your blood, and according to your salvation, Father God, your gospel, the good news.
and we declare healing right now in Jesus' name. We ask for every blood vessel to open up, for everything that is constricted, Father God, to loosen. We ask for the flow to come right now in Jesus' name. We ask for tension to be released. We ask, Father God, for healing to manifest in her head, Father God, and in her body. And we just ask, Father God, for her migraine to no longer be hers. It be desist and removed and cast out in Jesus' name. We ask for relief right now in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Amen and amen. I want one person who has the most faith to stand there until it manifests, but sit behind her and keep your hand on her and pray throughout the service. Under your breath, please. Don't be praying while I'm preaching. Be praying while I'm talking. I'm talking again, so. Y'all ready? Good. I like that sir stuff. Who's that? Who was that? All right. I got some young folks that need to learn that. Amen? Amen. All right. He's one of them. Punch him. Here we go. Isaiah 43:1. But now thus says the Lord who created you, O Jacob, he who formed you. Stay right here. Don't go to the next one. Who formed you, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by your name. You are mine. That scripture alone right there should make us excited. Amen. Well, you say, well, I'm not Israel. Yeah, you are. There's other places in the Bible you can see that you are the spiritual Israel. So I don't want to have to take that time to prove that to you right now. But that is the case. You are spiritual Israel. So that he's talking to you. And we need to grab hold of that. See, there's been, can you be really honest with me? How many have tired of the bull crap and tired of it just one thing after another and it just tired of the B-I-B-L-E. That's the book for me. Come on, get it back up. Really? How many's there? All right. So there's enough of us to get into unity and fight it, right? He said two or more. So there's more, right? So let's get into fighting mode. So if we got to come in here in what are those things? The little warrior? Kilt? Not a kilt. No, I don't want wrestling. That's too much like Speedo. I don't wear Speedos. The little warrior, Indian warrior skirt. Burlap. Burlap. You got to be a man to wear burlap on your in your underwears. I can just tell you that right now. I'll wear it first. All right. But we need to come in here all painted up and our warrior gear and stuff on our chest, whatever it needs. If you need help in your chest area, if you need to push this in, wear the girder, whatever. We need to get more warrior-like. Amen? We're wimpy, wimpy, wimpy. How many seen that new Hefty commercial? It's got John Cena. He comes up and that woman's like, I want that one. I don't want that one. How many wanted to be chosen and not be the wimpy one? Okay, we're expecting it just to happen. See, as we were singing that song, I'm listening to it, and it is, I'm going to tell you this because I know, because this is where I've been. See, I have put in, we started in 1994, Annette and I met, and in that, when we met, we were both coming to the Lord. I had already, was in the right in the middle of the divorce, and I had made my mind up to go back to the Lord and give him my all. And Annette was being drawn into the kingdom for the first time. And so we were all on. We were on fire. We were headed down the right road. We were going to do what God called us to do. And then he brought me and her together. And we, from the very beginning of our life, we have been on board with God
completely. Whenever I was down, she was up and she would carry us. Whenever she was down, I was up and I would carry us. There's very few times in our life that we were both down. God's been really gracious in that to carry us together through that. We have laid down our lives for the Lord. We have sown. We have plowed dead, dry ground. We have worked hard. We have given up a lot to do this work. And I'm not doing that in bragging. I'm just telling you that's what it costs. It costs you everything. And that's part of the problem is we don't want to give up everything. And eventually what happens is it gets all messed up. Because if you don't give everything, you're going to be in this sweet spot for a while, and you're going to be all gracious and all goodness and all this in that first period of life when he starts moving. But if you don't start giving him your all, come on, sit down. Hey, come on, it's all right. Oh, don't worry about it. Nobody's looking at you. Nobody's watching you right now. You're okay. Good. If you don't give it your all, eventually there's going to be a conflict, and you're going to find yourself in this never satisfied area. Now, when you are giving it your all and you're going through stuff, it's easy. Relatively speaking, it's easy. Y'all look at me like, you're a liar! No, it's not. I had given my everything to God, and Annette had given everything to God, and our daughter was killed in a car accident, and I was able to walk through that better and easier than I'm walking through what I'm walking through right now. I doubt God more now than I did then. I was wondering why. I was ticked off at him. We had some poignant discussions about his timing and about what was he doing. I had given him everything, and you're going to allow this to happen to me. I went through all that. But it was easier to go through that than to go through what I'm going through right now. And the reason is because I was all in, and it was all in his face. And all the disappointments and all the discouragements have caused me to back off a little bit more, and a little bit more here, and a little bit more here. And what has happened? I am so far behind, I can see my butt. Can I get a witness? And see, we want to get, and see what's going on right now. I'll just tell you right now in the church right now. I have more people saying I have the right to take some time off than we ever have. And the thing is, it's not that you don't have a right to take time off. It's that if you will pay attention to what's going on, you're not wanting to come here because you're dissatisfied. Not because you are resting, relaxing, and having a good time. And wherever you go seems the greatest on one extent, or it's the worst. It's one or the other. Because what happens is, I'm so dead with all that, all this is great, and the world seems awesome. Or you're just dead and dissatisfied, and it just depends on which way God's working you. Am I speaking truth? Am I all in your neighborhood? Because I'm the lead, I'm the head. I'm the shoulders, probably shoulders. That's probably where I'm at in the thing. Somewhere. I'm not the head. He's the head. But I've been messed up for 6 months. I have been messed up. And I have pulled way, 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 way away because I'm discouraged. It's just, and what was crazy, if I look back now, because as dead as it is in me, back then it wasn't nothing. It was a little disappointment. It was a little bit I didn't get my way. I would give anything to be there now than where we are now.
Because I know, you know just as well as I do when we walk in here going, oh crap, what's going to happen today? No one's going to be here. Phil's dead. The one thing about this church has always been the truth is when you walked in here, you could feel the presence. Right? Be honest. Be brutally honest. It's not as much anymore, is it? See, a lot of you want to say, no, it is, Pastor, because you want to be in faith and you want to be nice to me, but be honest. But see, you don't want to be honest because it's not just me. And most of you have kind of learned, yep, that's right, it's not just them, it's me, it's part of my fault too. Because I'm doing it, you're doing it too. I worked hard all week, I'm tired, I needed to stay home. We need some family time. I want you to picture yourself going into the throne room with Jesus Christ and having that conversation with him. That's what I do. When I'm thinking what I want to do is stupid, I think about that, or even when I think I'm intelligent, I'll think about going in and having that conversation with Jesus face to face and say, yeah, we want to have some family time. We want to go to the ballpark. We want to stay home and relax. Y'all are all quiet. I'm not beating you up. I'm talking to me. I'm not talking to y'all. Y'all are all Jesus' first cousins. Y'all ain't done nothing wrong. I'm talking about me. It's the truth. I'm sick more or less 6 months than I've ever been sick. I'm sick because I don't want to face all the garbage. Because when you walk in here with all of us, you get more convicted. Because somehow you know part of what's going on is part of your fault. Now, you won't admit that out loud. But deep down in your heart, you know, I'm not praying as much. I'm not doing as much. So you know you're part of the problem. Or you're in denial. And people in denial, they really know they just want to do everything they can to convince everybody else and their self that it's somebody else's fault. And I'm really, truly not beating you up. I'm just trying to be honest. I'm trying to talk about the elephant that's in the room. Because I'll be honest with you, this is not what my message was about. God just started opening my mouth and started talking. But we think, it's okay for me to get offended and leave. No, it's not. I don't care how bad I am as a leader or anybody else in here. It is not okay for you to get offended and leave your church. You are in disobedience and you are completely wrong if you're doing that. You're mad at the person or the situation, and God is using that to work something out of you. Believe me, I get offended at my leaders all the time. I was so upset with them today when I walked in here. I got four of them that didn't call in, didn't tell me, oh, I'm sick. We're a faith church. You know how sorry that sounds to God calling in sick in a faith church? Think about it. I know this one minister, if you're sick around, he said, I don't care, get up here, we'll pray for you. He's a evangelist, healing guy. Nobody can call in sick with him. And see, the thing is, I've called in sick. Why? Because I didn't want to face it. I understand. I'm not beating you up. I'm just, let's talk about it, let's fix it. Because it ain't going to get fixed no matter how much I try without you. You guys over there, too. I just can't see you. I know this is my fault. You all got to understand that. This is my fault. This ain't your fault. This is my fault. But you're now doing it, so as you follow me into it, you got to follow me out.
Are you irritated with me?
I've been irritated with you since yesterday. But that's okay.
I got my list on you, too. We're making decisions, justifying, because we're dissatisfied. And the thing is, the dissatisfaction is to make you go further and higher and deeper, not more shallow, less and stuck and backwards. The dissatisfaction is supposed to push you to go in further and more. But it's like we get so mad at ourselves and we get so mad at the whole situation, we just boom. This morning, I don't know how real do I want to be? Okay. I'm already in trouble with the net anyway, so here we go. This morning, we're both writing notes and looking at the Word. Do you know, it's been so long since I've sat in my chair and her in her chair and seen that going on. And it used to be every day, every morning, and most evenings. And you know what is crazy? Is that we think it's going to get better doing that. Because we think if we throw a tantrum long enough, God's going to fix us. Come on, really. We don't think that, but we think that. But the problem is that he's going to fix it. We're just not going to like the way he does it. You know, we think it's okay to do some of the things that we're doing, and we gotta stop. And so I really think all of that was to set up what God wants me to talk about in this Word. So give me however long it takes. Verse 1, Jacob is a heel catcher. He's a tripped up liar, and Israel is a prince. So he's talking to, hey, look, your bad side and your good side. But now, thus says the Lord, who created you, he knows you, he understands your issues. It's not here to beat you up. He says, who formed you? In other words, who created you, caused you into existence, and then who is also molding and shaping you? So he's saying, look, guys, I know that things are messed up, and I'm forming and shaping you into something new, so I'm talking to who you were and to who you're going to be. Fear not, I have redeemed you. I've paid the price. And I've called you. I've named you. How did I put it? This is a good note right here, so I need to go back to that one right here. He says, fear not. That word is fear morally. Knowing when you... knowing when you won't do according to the way, Jesus' way. And he says, I, the eternal, perfect, complete one, has called and redeemed you, bought back, paid the price, the ransom, avenged you for what you have done wrong. And I called you, I have declared who you are, and I've declared your name. I have a definite and conspicuous position. That name is appellation, identifying name and title. He says, I know how messed up you are, and I know you've made that stupid decision to pull back, do all the things that you are, and got you in this rut, but I have called and declared to you, and I've speak to that, and I've speak to the hope that you are supposed to be, and I'm naming you, and I'm declaring over you who you are. I'm declaring, and that which I speak will be, will not come back void. I declare into existence what is, and I'm speaking you to you this morning, and I'm declaring to you who you are this morning, and I am marking you, and it is marking you not anything but your mind. He said, you're mine, Point Christian Fellowship. He says, you're mine. He says, you're mine. You're mine. Verse 2.
When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overflow you. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, nor shall the flame scorch you. Sometimes when God is speaking through his word, it's double reference. It's both sides of the sword. It's both sides of the blade, okay? And so what he's speaking to you here is the water. The water is, this is still water. This is a body of water. And so he says, look, you're going to pass through that water. And in that water also means to be, to conceive. So what he's saying is things that loom up and consume you, I will get you through it. But also in the things that consume you or in what seems like is consuming you, what I'm doing is I am placing seed in you. You're conceiving and you're going to produce something. Okay, listen to what I'm saying. See, when we come up to the great sea, I'm going to part the sea and you're going to be able to walk through. So whatever whatever represents a big thing in your life that's an obstacle, I'm going to take care of that. Also, what he's speaking to you is that I'm going to plant a promise in you that's going to be big and overcoming, okay? So he's speaking both sides, the good and the bad. He's speaking to Jacob and he's speaking to Israel. Remember, because he said, I'm talking to Jacob and I'm talking to Israel. So he's saying, in here, I'm going to plant into you something good and I'm going to overcome what's bad. Amen? And then he's going to come to the waters, and this is moving water, okay? And then what he's speaking there is anything that rushes in and tries to overtake you, I'm going to battle. And then also then I'm going to cause you to be abundant and overflow in prosperity. That's what the word, those rivers right there, is talking about prosperity. So he's talking to anything that tries to come in and overtake you, I'm going to battle off and I'm going to take off and nothing's going to be able to overtake you. Then he's saying, look, I'm going to cause you to be abundant, prosperous, and that's not just in money, but that's in whatever you set your hand to. So he's speaking to both sides, amen? And then he says, the flame that comes against you, you're going to walk through it. And that flame that comes to consume you is not going to be able to consume you. What it is it's going to purify you. So the flame that comes to destroy you is going to be the flame that purifies you and cause you to be better than what you already are. I'm glad two people are excited about that. Eventually, all of you will be. I thank you, brother, for clapping. The rest of them are going to hell, but me and you will go to heaven. Amen? All right. I'm teasing a little. Okay, verse 3. For I am the Lord, your God, the Holy One of Israel. I am Jehovah. I am Yahweh, rather. I am the Jehovah. I am the self-existent one. I am your God, Elohim, the complete God. All three parts, body, soul, and spirit, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. I am the Holy One. I am the separated one of Israel, the one that is made to look and operate like God. I am your deliverer, your salvation, and I have given you a victory over Egypt bondage. I've given you victory. I've paid the bill against that which is darkness, Ethiopia, and to Seba, that is places of drink and intoxication and perversion. I have paid the price for bondage. I've paid the price for darkness or evilness that comes against you, and I've paid for those things that intoxify or seduce and come against you to pervert you and take you the wrong way. So he's saying, I'm speaking to everything that comes against you and tries to take you out. I have spoken against it, and it shall not overtake you. Amen? I know, it's like, okay, I heard this before. No, you haven't heard it before, because if you heard it before, right now it would be yes, because that's what he's doing in my life. But it's no, because he's not doing it in your life. Why? Because you have not said yes. You said maybe. Come on, I say maybe all the time. Because yes means dying on the cross. We want the resurrection. Hallelujah. But first, there is death. And that's where we get upset and whining. I whine. I whine a lot. I have my gun with me. Yeah, that's the unfortunate part. We're in Texas. Everybody's got a gun.
I just wonder sometimes, we put this out on the YouTube, how many people pull up our thing and go, oh my God. I know. But can you just imagine those Northerners, you know, those real liberals? They probably post us on the these are the devils. The devil, they're coming to take over our country. Them redneck. But anyway, says I am your God. I'm your God. And I'm taking care of the bondage. I'm taking care of the darkness. I'm taking care of anything that seduces you and that causes you to be delusional, causes you to be intoxicated. Because intoxication is awesome. I like champagne and Sprite. It's pretty good. It's kind of sweet. And we have drinks every once in a while. You all know that about me. But I was watching the game and I had a couple of those. And we were going to have a nice evening alone and celebrate the new year and love each other, but we decided to keep on with our tradition and fight. And I slept on the chair, and she slept in the bed, and I woke up like this. Sometimes my chair is comfortable, but when you sleep too long in it, it's like you wake up. Oh God, help me! You try to get up. The older you get, man, stuff hurts you didn't even know you had. God, you know, I've been thinking, I'm like, I'm only 50. What am I going to be like at 70? I got to change something. Amen? Amen. So anyway, I had a few of those and I felt myself get a little tipsy. And so when I start doing that, I try to stop. I don't know. It come out right. No, I'm being serious. I mean, he says don't be drunk, so I don't want to get drunk. So I start feeling tipsy, and I will stop. There's times that I don't, and I drink a little bit too much, and that's bad. It's a sin. It's sin. Okay, celebrating and getting tipsy and celebrating life. There's nothing wrong with it. Right. But when you get to that place, because see, once you start, you pass that place, then you start looking at the cheerleaders too long in the game. You start doing all those stupid things because your guard's down. That's the whole purpose of why he's getting you intoxicated. And so you'll put down the guard. You get more loosey-goosey. Right? And you say things you normally wouldn't say. And you do things you normally wouldn't do. Right? And then you tick your wife off, which I do that intoxicated or not, but I'm talented like that. But that he says, I'm coming against that which is in bondage and that which is that is darkness and that which intoxifies you and takes you to a place where you're not supposed to be. Verse 4, since you were precious in my sight, you have been honored, and I have loved you. Therefore, I will give men for you and people for your life. Now, God was really speaking to me on this morning, and give that to me in the King James. I want to show you something. Okay, if you give this in all different kinds of ways, it sounds like since thou was precious in my sight, thou hast been honorable, and I have loved thee, therefore I will give men for thee and people for thy life. If you look at that, it's kind of like, okay, since I looked at you and you were precious and you've been honorable, I have loved thee. But really what it's saying is because I have chosen you and because I have declared you, you are now precious. And you are honorable. And because you are, I'm going to cause men to come to you. And then that right there where it says, and people for thy life. In other words, I'm going to bring men to you, and I'm going to cause you to grow into a nation that's going to speak life. And now it takes a long time to break that down to show how that comes about. But what God is saying, because he's speaking to Jacob and Israel. He's speaking to what we were, to what we're becoming. And he's saying, look, no matter where you are in the process, I'm going to cause you to prosper, not because of who you are, but because of who I am. Amen? And so what he's saying is, no matter how much you messed up, no matter how much you got wrong in all that you're doing, I'm going to cause you to be precious and desirable and honorable, and I'm going to cause men, when men flock to us, what is that? It's resources. Causes the church to grow. You come in, you see a lot of people. Even if it's bad, you're like, hey, everything's okay. There's a lot of people here. But it also brings talents and gifts. Okay, that's the church, but into your life. See, if you've got the same people around you all the time and you don't have new people coming into you, you don't have new stuff coming into you. You don't expand your horizons, do you? Right? You don't grow. You stay stagnant. And you don't become great as a nation, and you don't explore all that you have. And when you do that, because God has saw you, made you precious and honorable, then he brings those, and then what you do is you become a nation that speaks, brings, declares life. Because and when we're not, and we're in here, what are we doing? When I was first talking, before y'all got engaged, and see, y'all are totally different now than you were when we first started. You're all dead, and now you're all, he's back. Dad's back. Hey, what's he going to say? It's either going to be good, crazy, or we're in trouble. But I got all your attention. You're all like, except Billy and Nisi, they don't care. They've heard it enough. We speak death. We declare death. You know what? Death sometimes can be made to sound look good, right? Doesn't it? Huh? The more we disguise death to look like life, the better it is and the more enticing and the more damage it does. See, like when you do a line of coke and you're like, Bill Cosby's definition or description of doing coke is the best. Because he talks about, the guy says, the guy's talking to Bill and he's trying to get him to try. Bill is not going to do it. He'd rather, never mind. Who told me to stop? Thank you. He's like, hey man, it intensifies everything about you and about everything. And Bill goes, well, what if you're an a-hole? Right? Pretty much. Didn't think of that. But, you do a line of coke, it's like, wow, that's awesome. And then you're partying and you do speed, it's like, wow, and you're like, oh, great, this is great. I can drink and party and all, get up the next morning and go to work, and it's all great, and oh, man, it's awesome. Then, somewhere between a month and a year into it, have you ever seen those pictures on people, the before and the after? I used to be one of those before pictures and after pictures. This hunk of sexiness. Yeah. I'm sexy and I know it. Anyway, I'm too sexy for my shirt. I used to love that song. Anyway. So, where was I going? I forgot. Huh? I know, but I was going to say something. Really. Oh, yeah. This sexiness was 130 pounds. 6'4". Actually, I've shrank. I'm about 6'3 and a half now. I don't know. Shh. I know. If you do push it up, you do go up. Yeah, you're probably right. I'm not as fat as I used to be. But can y'all imagine me 130 pounds? Yeah, I do.
But their jeans are so funny. You can't
move. Yeah, I had a mullet. I had a mullet with a perm. Business in the front, party in the back. I had jeans so tight, it's surprising I had kids. I was sexy. Anyway, 130 pounds. It looked good. It was good for a while. It was awesome. It was a great picture that he painted. But when you wake up every morning and stick a needle right in there, right in there. This one got so bad it collapsed. I wasn't so sexy. But hey, guys, how many's got a beautiful wife, but they're really more beautiful after the shower, in the hour, in the makeup room? Right? My point is that we can cover it up and look, we can make it look pretty for a while, right? How many of us are that after picture spiritually and we got a lot of makeup on? We got a lot of things covering up, right? I'm scared for the Lord to take me into the place of looking at myself spiritually right now. I wonder if I look like one of those after pictures. And some of you are freaking out, like the pastor's being this real, and yeah, that's who I am, and I'm never going to change. And as far as being real and telling you and talking to you, because I think that's best for you than for me to come up here and act like I've never been. Now, the thing is for me to have fewer of these and grow and progress and get better. And unfortunately, be more like Paul and have enough to where you don't have these issues. But for me to fake it and act spit polished and shined and lie to you, I think it's worse than messing up. You know, some people can't handle it. I understand that, and that's why we lose some people. People can't handle the way I talk sometimes. I understand that, and I do my best to watch what I say these days. And I'm trying, seriously, I'm trying to talk a certain way and to know which setting to be able to, because some people need to hear it. You know, and religiously, those that get offended about it, that, you know, they got maturity issues. But at the same token, I have maturity issues too, because see, the thing is even though it's okay what I say, and I can show you in the Bible where it is, the problem is maturity-wise, people aren't, and my liberty should never cause you to stumble. And so in my need to be right, I'm wrong. Now, what about you? So my point today's message is we've seen the elephant. We see him. What are we going to do? Are we going to shoot him and get rid of him? Or are we going to make him a pet and keep him around? Because no matter how much, I'm going to change because I can't take the way I am right now anymore. I can't take it. I can't take it. I am literally getting sick of myself. Physically sick of myself. So I'm going to change. But to change it in here, it's going to take more than me. Starts with me. But just as easily as you slip down the slippery slope of garbage with me, I want you to take that first step of climbing back up the hill with me. Can you do that? All right. That starts with today, when you go to bed, that you repent and you seek his face and you spend some time in his presence and in his word. That means tomorrow you get up, and I'm not looking for an hour or 2 hours. I'm looking for a few minutes with him, praying and reading and seeking his will and what he wants, not what you want and what you want to justify. Because if you start up in the morning trying to justify anything, we're going to stay and remain here. Because the first thing he's going to do is start cleaning and fixing things in us. He's going to make us change some things, some attitudes, even when we're right. See, me and Annette's got some things to get fixed, and I know that I'm right in some areas, and I know that she's right in some areas, but we are not going to get it fixed unless we will concede in the areas that we know we're right. And so as he works on you and starts changing you, he's going to confront you first. And then he's going to empower you to make the changes in the other places. That's doing the ministry that you're supposed to do, encouraging others, loving others, and getting people back in, speaking life to them, loving on them. Because we got to instill hope. We got to bring hope, and we got to be hope. Amen? So, I've challenged you for 2017. In the years past, I've declared a word over what I thought was supposed to be. And really, I didn't go all into this message, and I may finish it up next week. Because one of the things that we're going to change in here is that we're going to start doing series on Sundays, and we're going to start promoting what those series are, and we're going to go after, I'll be honest with you, because most of you are home folks. Sunday morning is going to go after non-believers. I want you to get them here Sunday morning. Wednesday night is going to be ecclesia. It's going to be for the mature. We're going to come in. We're probably not going to do any announcements. We're going to come in. We're going to go into praise and worship. And either we're going to go into nothing but the Spirit move, or we're going to go into prayer, or we're going to go into some hard get-in-your-face word. Deep word. That we're going to go into those three areas. That's what we're going to do Wednesday nights. And then Sunday morning is going to be, we're going to have series, and we're going to promote it. You're going to have that series, and you're going to be able to go get people out and give that to them and say, hey, this is coming up, and hey, won't you come and hear this? It's going to be talk about prosperity. It's going to talk about how to deal with all of those things. We're going to speak in that. So we're going to try to reach out to the community, and we're going to try to reach out and get people in here on Sunday morning. And then that's what Sunday morning. So you all in here, you're coming to work on Sunday morning. You're not coming to... Then Wednesday night will be for us to get in his presence and see what he wants to do for us and give us instruction. And then we're going to promote and push Destiny Discovery to get people grown up in the Word. Amen? All right, I love you very much. Let's go root for the Cowboys to beat the snot out of Billy's Eagles. Let's bow our heads. Lord, I love you. Help me. Lord, help them. Amen.